So straight. So he received his PhD from the University of Queensland more than 20 years ago, and then did a postdoc at Princeton. And there, I think he did some Raleigh scattering from optically trapped molecules. From precisely which molecules they were, but he tell us. And then went on a lectureship position at Heriot's Law, which is in Edinburgh, Scotland. And on a fellowship, research fellowship, went to UCL, and where he has now become a full professor since 2006. I knew him from the time when he was interested in trapping and moving molecules. I think he still has some hands in it. But somewhere along the line, he decided the molecules maybe were too small, or too boring, or too complicated, I don't know which, but he decided to get onto these nano devices, and where he is now putting a lot of effort into it on cavity cooling of, for instance, nanoparticles, levitated nanoparticles. His ultimate aim is to sort of get to the ground state, the quantum ground state, to sort of test some of these esoteric and exotic models of the collapse model, the modification of the Schrodinger equation. So, but that, I think, is going to be the title of what he's going to focus on today. So, please.
Well, thanks very much for the invitation. And, very interesting tools that I've had. Quite nice. I'm going to talk about the experiments that I'm doing, and talk a little bit about what other people are doing in terms of. So I call this a quantum optical mechanics with limited nanoscale oscillators, but I'll also talk about other applications. To hopefully give you a bit of flavor of this subject and also what we do in it. So that's a picture of UCL, which is in the center of London. It's rather dark now, but not quite as bright as the nice weather we've got here. So to motivate this, I just wanted to sort of talk about this field of optical mechanics and cavity optical mechanics. In general, and so this is kind of at one end of this scale is perhaps LIGO, which is kind of the ultimate cavity optical mechanics experiment, and which is essentially oscillating mirrors. And at the other end, there's probably trapped atoms, which is the other end of this sort of zoo of different structures. And so what we're interested in is essentially, you know, control and cooling at a quantum level with these systems. So these systems are interesting because they can be engineered. So they can be very engineered, so you can engineer the optical properties, the mechanical properties of these systems to various degrees and to various success. So some of these systems are already quantum systems, so that is that you can at least cool them down to the ground state, and you can look at things like optomechanical squeezing. So it's a new kind of playground that I guess for me extends from atomic molecular physics and some of the concepts in atomic molecular physics that you can apply to these more macroscopic systems. So you can look at these systems and look at the quantum mechanics of the systems, which is what I'm primarily interested in, but of course because you can engineer them, they are useful as sensors. And if I have time, I'll talk about a sensor, not a quantum sensor, but a sensor that has developed from our system here. So my interest is in this idea of limited optical mechanics. So this is a particular area of this whole larger area of optical mechanics. And this is where we essentially have a single particle, or can be many, but a single nanoparticle, that in some ways is just like an atomic system. I mean, it's a polarizable sphere. And And so we can look at that interaction with a cavity, for example. And it's very much like an atomic system in that because it's levitated, it's insulated from the environment to some extent. And I'll explain why that is. That's certainly an oversimplification, and of course you're never really decoupled from the environment. But it's interesting in that if you have a tethered system like a spring, so you've got a fixed spring constant. So the nice thing about using external fields, such as a laser field or an electric field or a magnetic field, is that you can control this spring constant. But importantly, also, somewhat like an atomic physics experiment, I can actually drop this thing, so I can release it, and so I can potentially do things like metal wave interferometry with these microscopic objects. And so we're talking about objects that consist of billions of atoms. So it certainly is macroscopic in terms of an atomic system. So this is interesting because it's optical trapping in a new regime, actually. So initially, Arthur Ashkin trapped particles in vacuum and quickly moved on to trapping in solution. But it's kind of this underdamped regime where essentially there is no gas. It's quite a new regime for optical trapping. So there's lots of kind of fun things to do. The main reason, of course, the main motivation is really to test quantum mechanics at this macroscopic scale. So really, can we create a non-classical system? Can we create a classical position? Can we create quantum states of these massive objects? And I'll briefly talk about this. There are also models, some reasons why you may not be able to get, for example, a cascade superposition of these macroscopic systems. And I'll talk a little bit about how we can go about measuring that. Also, this is a nice system. It's a very underdamped system, so it's high mechanical Q. So mechanical Q is on the order of 11 or 12. And so it becomes, it becomes another way, a very sensitive force sensor. And so there are ideas for measuring gravitational waves at high frequency and looking at gravity at small wave scales using a single trap particle. Of course, so we can never trap with green light very successfully, but you can at least see green light, which is why I'm showing that. So perhaps the first experiment that many people would like to do is to really just do some matter wave interferometry. So if I can cool this particle down, it doesn't need to be in a ground state or anything like that, it just needs to be cold enough such that I can get some interference. And so here's a proposal to do this sort of thing by essentially just trapping and cooling a particle, turning off the field, dropping it through essentially a light grating, a lattice, and then looking at where particles arrive on this detector, essentially measuring an interference pattern. And of course, if you can see an interference pattern, then you can also test how that interference pattern might change due to decoherence in the system. Or, for example, if for some reason these systems cannot be quantum systems. So this is a attractive way of doing things. Perhaps the only trouble is I need to cool many of these and drop them simultaneously. So I need to do it 10,000 times, which currently would be a bit of an issue. There's other ways of doing matter wave interferometry as well. So people have shown me a little bit about some of the NV experiments. So this is an idea where essentially if I take nanodiamond with an embedded NV. I create a superposition in the spin, so plus or minus one in the electronic spin, and then I have a non-uniform magnetic field. So this system would normally be oscillating, and now I have essentially a superposition, an internal spin superposition, which through this gradient in the field I can induce a set of mass superposition. And so even tilting this slightly with respect to the horizontal, then you can expect that as you come back, you can essentially measure a phase shift between each of these oscillations in the gradient of the magnetic field. And so you can do a type of Ramsey experiment and you can look, you can essentially see if you can evidence at least a superposition. Now, so for this experiment, the actual superposition is quite small. It's on the order of picometers. But it indicates that, so you might ask yourself, well, if actually this particle is on the order of 100 nanometers, and I have a certain mass superposition, I'll say a picometer is meaningful. That would be a valid question, perhaps. And so we've looked at ideas of basically amplifying this effect so we can get the superposition much larger than a picometer, more like tens of microns. And so this is the sort of experiments that we're moving towards. But really, what we need to do is gain the control over these systems like you have over atomic systems. So we work with a number of theorists, and one is Siddhartha Bose, and this really is primarily his idea. The idea here is to test whether gravity is quantum by evidencing essentially entanglement between these two superpositions. So essentially, I showed you how we could potentially create a single superposition with a center of mass superposition with a single NV nanodiamond. If we do two and look at their gravitational interaction, the fact that there is entanglement through gravity would mean that gravity is essentially a quantum entity. It doesn't tell you anything else other than that, but that would be kind of an interesting first step. So as I said, you know, we're a little ways off doing this sort of experiment because we really need to get the superposition of a single particle. But so many people are thinking about this, and particularly people in Vienna, really, with a kind of a consortium of people throughout Europe, is to can we do some of these experiments? And these experiments would probably have to be done, or at least eventually in space, because you need essentially a long time to carry out these experiments to actually establish superposition. But there is plans, and we're not the only people thinking about this. So, for example, here's some experiments that Andrew Garisi, who's now at Northwestern, is interested in doing, and that is using really these small masses on the order of a micron to test forces over small length scales. And so this is also another idea here, is that to use this the sensitivity of this system to measure gravitational waves at high frequencies. And their predictions show that at least at these high frequencies, you would be like, open. The question is, are there gravitational waves at 30 to 100 kilohertz? And there are models for it, but that is certainly something we'd like to try. If I have time, I'll talk a little bit more about that. So as I said, kind of what we need is control over these systems. Okay, so we need the experimental methods to do this theory as usual, it's way ahead. So what I wanted to primarily talk about is progress in general, and in particular the progress that we have made towards doing these experiments. So Jan Giesler, who is working here within the group of Brooks and Lockman, has done a lot of essentially feedback cooling, and they're down in the 10 to 100 microkelvin range for the center of mass motion of these particles that are trapped in a single tweezers. What I'm going to talk about, part of my talk today, is really how we do this cooling of this center of mass motion using a cavity. System actually that these are charged nanospheres. So the issues have been really, I said, you know, this is a nice isolated system. Well, that's good in some sense because, yes, certainly it's an isolated system, but it also means that if you have any heat in the system, it's hard to get away, and this is really a dense matter system. So any absorption of light can lead to problems. And so, you know, at least at the moment, the main sort of sources of decoherence are really collisions with surrounding gas. So in order to really have a proper system, you need to be at 10 or something like that. Then, of course, recoil is an issue as well. So this is basically heating that you get in atomic systems, but you get the same sort of thing in a sphere as well. some temperature than this black body radiation, which if you're trying to create a superposition, this will localize it for a particular color. And so what I'm going to talk about is our cooling experiments that we've done that would get down to the millikelvin range, and then some of these refrigeration experiments that actually cool the internal degrees of freedom, so where we cool components of the system, so cool the centrifugal mass motion. And then what I would like to do is talk about some of the future applications. So let me talk about cavity cooling. So what we have is a nanosphere here, which is in vacuum, which is, it's a charged nanosphere, so it's held lightly by this ball trap, which is created essentially by this RF field on two needle electrodes. And then we have a cavity around the levitating particle. And we do cavity cooling. So cavity cooling has been developed again for atomic systems. And the beauty of cavity cooling is that, of course, you don't need any transition. You just need a particle that's polarizable. And so what happens in this case, if you have a cavity field, and if you have the field detuned to the grid of the cavity, then so you get a situation like this, where you get side bands due to the mechanical motion. Okay? And if you engineer this such that the side bands, the blue-shifted side band, is resonant with the cavity, then you can take mechanical motion out of the system. That's how you can cool it. You can also heat it by moving to the blue side, or you can do nothing if you're in the dark on the resonance. And so this is what we do. It's slightly different in that we also have a ball trap, which also takes a role in this cooling process. So if you consider a time domain picture of this, you have this atom oscillating backwards towards this antinode. It's essentially shifting the resonance frequency. But because it's a high finesse cavity, there's a time delay between when something happens mechanically and when the light escapes. And it's this time delay which is quite important if you're in one of this side bend regime where essentially this is the line width of the cavity. Is less than the mechanical frequency. Okay. So let me describe. So people have done this for atomic systems, but it seems cavity cooling is in many ways better for this system because the polarized bit is large. Because even though it's a non-resonant process, the polarized bit is large, and so the coupling to the cavity can be quite large. And so the coupling essentially is proportional to polarizability and inversely proportional to the cavity volume. So we'd like to just look at cavity volume to do this. And so what it looks like, so if you look at this potential, we have this potential that's created by the cavity, which is this periodic lattice, which is overlaid on this the potential that you get from the ball trap, which is large and deep here. So one of the important things is you can imagine that this particle is oscillating backwards and forwards in this standing wave, for example. So it would naturally like to sit on an edge node, so on a high-intensity region. So if you're cooling, and you're cooling basically down to this edge node, eventually you don't modulate the cavity. And so what you need to do is to pull the particle away from the edge node to increase the cooling rate. In fact, the maximum cooling is found on the slope here of the three. So actually what the ball trap does is because it's oscillating backwards and forwards at a lower frequency, it periodically pulls this particle away from the antinode. And so we can enhance the cooling by the micromotion that you get in a ball trap, which is exactly the opposite to what you would expect in a normal atomic ball trap, where micromotion leads to heating. So in our case, it leads to cooling. And so essentially, if you look at these equations, motion, momentum and the optical field, then you get this cooling process. And so if you look at this process here, so you have a particle that's moving through these wells, it's cooling and then eventually localizes on a fridge here, And this micromotion that you see is periodically pulling this particle away from the fringe. And so essentially, if you look at this from a camera, you'll see the particle gets localized. So this is a particle that's already localized. But if you perturb it, eventually it locks onto cools down and locks onto a fringe. And that's what you're seeing there. So the sort of temperatures that we can get are on the order of a millikelvin, and I'll tell you what that's sort of limited by. And so you can see a single particle here. This is the high finesse cavity, which is has a finesse of up to 400,000. The only problem is sometimes if you get one of these particles, which is on the order of about 200 nanometers, and they land on the mirror here, then immediately finesse will go down to about 20. So you have to be careful. And so this is an image of how we put these particles in. One way that we put them in is we have a quadrupole guide, and we use an electrospray, which is essentially a process of charging these particles. You can see there a string of them that feed them in separately in the trap. This trap here, or a different trap. So, okay, so this is how we do this. So we have essentially an optical cavity, and a full trap of particles inside. And we have a weak beam which allows us to lock one laser to the cavity, and then we essentially offset lock another laser to do the cooling. So we can set up any tuning that we want, and then we have a homodyne detection method to look at the mechanical motion. And so showing this, so this is it. This is where we have to have a finesse that's 40,000, not 400,000, because we have a particle that landed on the thing. That what you see here is the mechanical motion. But we also set up measure hexagon as well. So these are the side bands of the motion. And so what you see is essentially as you reduce the pressure down to about 10⁻⁶ millibars, you no longer see this mechanical motion. So you can see the particles there, but we've actually cooled it enough. Well, basically down to the noise floor of where we can currently go. And so if I look at this, you can essentially get a temperature from the area. So this is the power spectrum density function frequency, essentially the mechanical motion. So this is one of the sidebands. And as you look at the integrated area under this curve, temperature. And so you can see, essentially, as the pressure decreases, down to this point here, where the noise floor temperature. So this, as I said, you know, so then we have this coupling of about 8 millivolts. We have about 3 charges on the silicon here, which has a radius of about 209 nanometers. Mass in this case, about 10⁻⁶. And we can tune the mechanical frequency, so the tracking frequency of this, by essentially changing the intensity of the tracking of the cavity beam. So where do we need to be, actually? So we need to be, you know, on the order of 10 microkelvin. So I'll talk a little bit about that. But before I do, what's interesting is that, so the cavity field affects the ball trap, so it's essentially like having a DC, it's the equivalent of having a DC field that you would have on a ball trap. And so essentially we can move the secular frequency around. It's essentially like changing the potential we would have on a ball trap. So we can tune the secular motion as well, which essentially is not important, but interesting. So essentially we're limited by noise, and we're limited mainly by the frequency noise of the laser system, and also mechanical noise. So we're operating at fairly low frequencies on the order of 100 kilohertz, and we're very sensitive to essentially the motion of the mirrors that we have. And so we're going through this process of improving this experiment. So so we have a filter cathode, which actually filters out the frequency noise. So it's essentially like a low-pass filter. So it filters at 2.5 kilohertz. And then we have the mirror, the mirrors that we use in the cooling now on this double isolation stage for the and so this is what this experiment looks like. So we have this waveguide here where we can load a single charged particle into the trap. And you can see here we can kind of string these particles. But importantly, with this new system, we should be able to get essentially down to order of photons for the system that we have. If we so you can see the noise here is completely dominated by the frequency noise. And this is kind of the best laser you can get. And this is where we've actually cleaned it up considerably using this mode cleaner. If we go down to 500 hertz line width, then we can do better. We can get sub one photon, so to the ground state. But also, actually, if we can increase the number of charges so that we can get the secular frequency out, we don't even need to actually track the cavity field. And so in that case, we don't get to the ground state field. And the question is, you know, can we get the tracking frequency high enough in these systems? So we already we're up to about 10,000 charges on these nanospheres, and we'd like about 100,000. That seems a little challenging. So, a number of groups are now sort of fairly close to the ground state, and we sort of expect to be there in the next 6 months, a year, based on these improvements that we have. So, you know, what can we do next? The nice thing about this combination of having this Paul trap as well as the optical potential is that we can get nonlinear potential, so we can get away from a parabolic. So, for example, with the pole trap that we have, we put you know, change the end cap potential so that we can sort of stretch this harmonic potential that's at the bottom of a lattice to something cubic sort of potential. So the community is already in a situation where you could do trap interferometry, but the issue there is that we need to do experiments for thousands of times. And that, you know, that may be feasible soon, but it really means that we have to have a system where we can trap one, drop it, trap it, and have the system stable over quite a long period of time. So a kind of low-hanging fruit is a test of these so-called flash models. So let me sort of describe that. So for example, if we create a superposition represented by this diagram here, and if there's some collapse that localizes it, and you can go through this process again. And there's an idea such that at some point, when you get macroscopic enough, that eventually that this could lead to a collapse of the wave function based on how macroscopic the system is, so basically based on the number of particles that your oscillator consists of. So there are a number of theories, and sort of many of these theories are really non-logical. And so, you know, in a sense, there isn't really any traceable physics in it. But a lot of people really have put bounds based on some positions, really. But it's something that we could test, right? Readily with these, and so the mass at which this collapse is supposed to happen is kind of the masses that we're working at. So the idea here is that there's this collapse process, and I've had the chance that it goes to this rate lambda, and that rate is inversely proportional to the mass. Okay, and there are so it's phenomenological, so there's no real kind of good number. numbers for this. It just looks like decoherence. So how can you differentiate between decoherence and a collapse process? And so that's something that we looked at. So the object also has to be large enough for this collapse rate, this so-called CSL rate, to be large enough, but small enough that other, you know, technical decoherence mechanisms don't dominate. And so this collapse rate, this lambda CSL, is a testable experiment. And there are a whole range of these that go from 10 to minus 7 up to 10 to minus 8. And so people have been testing these things over the years. So one obvious way of doing this would be to do this interferometry experiment that I discussed. And what you essentially would see is that your fringe contrast and your interferometry would eventually decrease as you could change the mass. Okay? But as I said, that's kind of a tricky experiment to do. There are also other non-interferometric tests. So if you consider this this collapse rate as a stochastic process, then it introduces noise that you can potentially measure, so excess noise in your system. And so this is kind of one of the most recent experiments Andrea Minante has undertaken, where he has a, so this is again an optical mechanical type experiment, using a magnetomechanical experiment where you have a hair tube and you have a magnet on the end, and you measure essentially what the displacement of these screws. And so essentially they measure a PSD as they change the temperature. And actually what I haven't shown here is that they find some excess noise that they can't attribute to anything. And so this sort of fits into, so this is a plot of experiments that people have done based on, so this is the collapse. And so there are a range of experiments, for example, LISA Pathfinder, interferometry experiments, a range of experiments, and essentially you can slowly looking into this parallel space. And this is the most recent one here by Benante, which actually did show some excess noise. But of course the trouble is, as I said, you know, how, if you see noise, how do you know it's not some sort of decoherence mechanism that you don't understand? And so we now have a project actually with Andrea Benante and others to do this with these levitated systems. And so we would like to measure some excess noise. So the idea here is that you essentially cool your particle, you turn off the light, and you take into account all the noise sources, black body, radiation, gas, and fluctuations in trapping potential, but also potentially this CSL noise mechanism. And a way to do that is in our trap we can optically cool it, and importantly we can turn off the light, because light leads to heating, recoil heating at best, but also additional heating if you heat up the particle itself, so black body radiation is significant. So the idea is you turn it off and then you let this particle evolve and you measure essentially the Bonnot number or the amplitude of the oscillation. And so if you look at sort of standard quantum mechanics, then you get a certain heating rate and you would, if you included CSL and 10^-8 Hz, you get an increase. So the idea is you essentially you cool your particle, you leave it in the dark for a while, and then you make a measurement of temperature. And so this really doesn't tell you much again. It just tell you that you haven't characterized the decoherence in your system. But if you look at the different properties, so if you look at the pressure here, you get this deviation of 10^-8 calculations from the different collapse rates. But also with radius, for example, there's quite a very different dependence if you include collapse rate compared to if you're just essentially, if you have no collapse mechanism. And so this is kind of a nice, this would be a nice way of doing things because there's some functional So, okay, so sort of want to talk a little bit about, so we have this control over the center of mass motion. But the trouble is, these are condensed matter systems, they can have small impurities. If this is such an isolated system, then of course, it can heat up, absorbing even a very small amount of the light. And over time, since there's no way for the light to escape other than black body radiation, you can get quite hot. And so so recently we looked at ways of internally cooling the system. And a paper that came out last year as Andrew Garrison called it, Levitate the Fridge. So let me describe that. So previously we and others had done measurements of trapped particles, and we noticed that if you looked at the Brownian motion of these particles, even with a small amount of gas, then you get very much enhanced Brownian motion due to the fact that if you're heating something up and you're having collisions, then that imparts a recoil to this. And so we could actually measure the temperature was different due to Brownian motion along the axis of the laser beam compared to orthogonal to it, because this was essentially acting like a lens. And so this was quite a significant effect in that actually just eliminating the laser with a normal trapping beam, we've actually melt the particles. These are silica spheres. And what would happen is you trap this particle, it could get so hot that it would start evaporating, and it eventually it would evaporate to a point where the volume was low enough that it wasn't absorbing so much. So it's a good way of changing the particle size to the point where you could easily trap. But even so, typically trap temperatures are probably on the order of 1,000 Kelvin. So you really would like to be at 300 Kelvin at least, but we're certainly well above that. And so it's become important if we want to really continue in this field in many ways, then we need to do internal refrigeration as well. And so I mentioned this experiment before where we were interested in essentially doing this interferometry method and be embedded in a nanodiamond. And so, you know, if you're getting up to 1,000 Kelvin, then, you know, this affects spin incoherence times. That eventually we've actually shown in these experiments, if you don't have clean diamond, then you eventually burn, you actually turn the diamond into graphite. So this is an extreme case, but so actually what you could do is you could burn off some of this, because some of the diamond actually is graphite, and you get significant absorption. You can burn it off, bring it up, but eventually if you take it down too far, then no longer have diamond. And so this is a pretty extreme case, but something that we needed to address. And so there's a whole community out there who looks at laser cooling of solids, and this has been predicted since 1929, but it's not only in really the last 10 years that people can cool these solids. And so people have been able to cool down to about 90 Kelvin. And essentially, most of our experiments are at 90 Kelvin. We don't have any real problems with black body radiation. No lower, that's even more interesting. So someone had done an experiment actually in water with trapped nanocrystals, and they could show that they could get about a 20 degree change. And so the thought is, if you do this where there is no conduction to the water, then you should be able to get more energy. So this is how this works. So this is an interesting system. These are ytterbium 3 plus ions embedded in a crystal of yttrium-lithium fluoride. And so this is the rare earth. And the nice thing about the rare earth is these optical transitions, as I said, they're allowed by that crystal field mixing. That is metal light. But importantly, there's very little non-radiant relaxation. So the only way for this system to relax is through the emission of photons. And so if you pump on the gap between this and the ground, the electronic state, the first electronic state, you have this manifold of star shifted levels on the degenerate. And so you have this band, the excited state band, and it's an unresolved band. So the important thing is that the lifetime of the electronic states is on the order of milliseconds, but you get very rapid thermal relaxation here on the order of milliseconds. And so what this allows you to do, if you pump on the band gap here, then you get fast redistribution, so you get thermalization, and then you get emission that's blue shifted, and it's that blue shifted emission, just as the blue shifted emission goes to the cavity, leads to cooling of the center mass motion. Here it leads to cooling of the phonons. And so this kind of it's a nice crystal because so it has this property that you can internally cool it, but it's also birefringent, and so you can actually control the rotational degrees of freedom as well. And so what we did is we didn't have any real source of these, but with Romania we could buy some laser crystals. So we bought some laser crystals and just crushed them up and sprayed them into a trap. So we used an asthma nebulizer to spray these colors in the trap. Both the internal motion and the center of mass motion. So this is like an extremely simple experiment. You have two lasers here. Both are trapping. So the laser that traps also cools. Okay? So you focus this down on the microscope perspective. And you have these attenuated particles that you trap at the focus. So we can trap either with this 1031 nanometers, which is a bit close to the band gap. So we can expect different temperatures and different particles. You can look at back reflected light and look at the fluorescence, and from that you can get a measurement of the internal temperature. And if I change the polarization of this, so what you do is if you essentially just look at the spectra and you get a Boltzmann distribution from the spectra, and you just read up the temperature. So the lowest temperature we got in our case is about 130 Kelvin, and that's limited by the fact that we didn't at the time have a laser that we could pump on the band gap. And we can essentially very much depends on the different particles. These are different particles. The last one could be 130. You can see that there's a range of about 150 or so average temperature. If we move it to another laser at 1064, we can see that we get higher temperatures. So we can kind of, using the wavelength of the laser, we can tune the temperature of this crystal that we have trapped. So it seemed too good to be true, because any impurities in these systems prevent cooling. So we weren't 100% sure that we believe the Boltzmann distribution. But I showed you before that if you have a particle that's trapped in a gas, for example, and there are collisions with the gas, then if the particle is hotter than the gas, then the particles that collide and leave at a high temperature. And so you have increased Browning motion and increased temperature. And so you could look at this PSD of motion, essentially by looking at the scattered light, and from the width of it, you can get a temperature. So this is a center of mass temperature, though, that's reflected by the fact that there's a bar of gas that's being modified. And so what you can show is that even at half an atmosphere, actually, which is quite a heat load, we can cool down quite impressive. So the cooling rate is very significant. So not only can we look at the center of mass motion, we can look at Brownian motion of the rotation as well. And they all give us numbers that are consistent with the numbers that we measure from the spectra. So we're sort of fairly confident that these Okay, so in the refrigerator, 130 Kelvin, we expect to be able to get down to 90 Kelvin by substituting the back, laser in the back, crystals. But the fundamental temperature, so you know, the question is, can we get down to 4 Kelvin, for example? This is an interesting what we call a nano cryostat that we can use for cooling, for example, in any sense to low temperature. You can imagine you could put one of these crystals on the end of a fiber and have it isolated enough so that you can have this very localized cold system. So the temperature is limited. Essentially, if you cool in this way, if you're cooling on this band gap, essentially you cool enough that there's no population for the population in the ground gap up ground state. And the question is, can you go cooler than that? And the answer is you probably can by putting in a cavity. So you even though you can't control the atomic structure that you've got, you can control the atomic density states. And so the idea of this. The next thing that we're going to do, which is why I asked some of you guys questions about your cavities, is that we would like to put these crystals into these nano cavities. And so in that case, I think we can get down to the order of 10 Kelvin on this micro scale. These particles have been grown around the other particles we have. So there's kind of a lot that we're interested in exploring in this particular case. Okay, so I'm just going to take a little segue away from what I was talking about and talk about something that has starting to become a sort of a commercial proposition. And so some time ago, we had a paper basically on Dr. Cooley, a microsphere. And this eventually led to a PhD project essentially, this is a glass sphere on a cantilever with a tapered fiber. And because we can introduce an evanescent field into this high Q cavity, so this has Q, optical Q on the order of 10 to the 7, the coupling strength of light is very much dependent on the spacing, so picometer spacing is a significant change in coupling. So we can use this idea as... So initially we were looking at cooling this system, but it turned out, because it's quite massive, it's quite sensitive to measuring acceleration. And so this is the system that we have here. So there's a sphere on the end of the cantilever, and what you can see here is the fiber that we use to put light in and get light out and measure how that coupling changes as a function of the separation between the fiber. And so this is essentially what we're measuring is the acceleration in this direction. And we can measure that by just essentially looking at the change in light transmitted through this fiber as it gets coupled in and out of this as the device oscillates or moves due to some acceleration, whether it be static gravity or something else. So this was her experiment. Do this. And so recently we have made a system that actually can be deployed. It's still a much larger system. If you think of the size of this, it's on the order of 100 microns. And so this is still quite large, but it's actually quite small compared to the optical cable that existed before. And this is a device that can be mounted onto a device. Without any work at all, this system is quite a robust system. Which at that time had essentially a thermal acceleration of about 0.6 microgs per hertz, with a bandwidth on the order of to 20 kilohertz. So this is kind of without actually doing anything, with just taking that system out of the lab and actually putting it on this platform was a very competitive accelerator. And so what we actually there in support only, it was, yes.
What was the ADXL?
It's an analog devices, one that you could buy. It's the sort of thing that you would, actually I think you don't, it's a sort of accelerometer that you can just buy. It's probably better than what you have in the phone, but but the idea is what we would like to do is to take this accelerometer and basically put it into, have it in phones or actually, as I'll show you why it's kind of interesting for things like autonomous vehicles because of other features which I've briefly talked about. And so, so in this system, so one of the things we were concerned about is, you know, it's tapered fiber, it has, you know, it's some micron size. We just fall apart, but actually the system was great. It actually had a much higher dynamic range than the commercial sensors we were using. It was faster, and actually it supplied 70G acceleration. This is actually really a comparison between a commercial sensor and our sensor. So this is attractive though, because you can make an accelerometer, but you can also make a gyroscope. Essentially, if you have an oscillation in another frequency, in a orthogonal direction, and you look at how much of that motion is in the motion that you're measuring, then this is a vibratory, called a vibratory gyroscope, which you can use to measure rotations. But on top of that, actually, this system is really interesting because you can put a frequency cone in the same detector and use it as timing. So that's kind of this timing component is something that doesn't exist in any other type of accelerometer. It's a very interesting component of this system that you could potentially have an accelerometer, gyroscope, and timing in one device. And so that's, for example, why it's interesting for autonomous vehicles, because it's this precise timing that's needed when you don't have access to GPS. So we think it's an interesting proposition. That's something that had a lot of interest. So it's about time I finished. So just concluding remarks about this range of applications for cooled nanoscale oscillators. So I've talked about our experiments, which will be cavity cooling. I talked about this next stage, really, to look at, to test these flat models. And I'm going to talk about this finally this more. Because most of our work is really looking at some fundamental things such as collapse and looking at macroscopic quantum mechanics. So it's kind of nice to see that also that this commercial venture has stayed from this work that we're doing. So, thanks for your attention. Certainly you can do two on one. Three might be a challenge, although we have worked that way so you could do that, but it might make sense to really have two.
Other questions?
How much does a commercial system cost?
The ones that we would be
this
No. Well, some ways, but not.
it's microscopic time movement. It's sort of a test of quantum gravity.
Yeah.
How does it work, this proposal? Why is it a test of quantum gravity?
Well, I mean, the only way that you can get the stable is quantum.
Quantum system.
Yeah, so it's that simple, really.
Very.
Why is it quantum gravity?
Well, as I said, if the interaction is quantum, so there's a gravitational interaction, quantum property, you can only get entanglement through a quantum process. So if it's a classical process, you can't get the entanglement. So that's the, so it's kind of it's kind of a simple, very simple idea, in a sense, but and it doesn't tell you anything about it other than whether it is or not.
So that's probably a very naive question that's maybe related to this. So you talk about maybe hopefully in the future you'll be down to the ground state. This is the vibrational ground state within these traps.
Yes.
And does it matter if the internal degrees of freedom how cold they are as well? So the super
well, it does fast. Eventually. I think as if it gets too hot, then black body radiation.
But it's only through black body radiation that you worry about it, or is there other degrees of freedom that can couple?
Well, I mean, that's I'd say the most important one. I mean, there are other degrees of freedom. I mean, there's rotation, and also there's actually internal vibration of the material itself. But they're much, much higher frequencies. And so if the thing has a 300 Kelvin, that shouldn't be a problem. It's really the temperature one is the way they outline. So if we can maintain this at 300 Kelvin,
could you
talk
about how your system to measure these kind of
glass
walls compares to other
things? Well, I think, I mean, the thing that I pointed out is that because we can change the mass so readily, and we can change the spring constant, we can basically tune across this range. And at least from the sort of simple calculations that we have, the fact that you can see that there's, you know, there's a functional change in collapse as you change that kind of provides a better signature than what we can currently do. I mean, also it's a much more isolated system than the systems that work on the temperatures that you get lower, so it's also attractive for that reason as well. So just for thermal models.
I guess it's also related to what Sam was asking about. So even when you turn off the light,
yeah.
You have these two two particles or something, and they have maybe van der Waals between
them.
You know, by the way, I didn't have to use quantum mechanics to write the Hamiltonian for van der Waals in practice. I mean, to derive it, fine, but I mean, I just put 1/r6 in my equation.
Yeah.
It depends on position,
yeah.
And maybe it will be coherent position. So, and I don't know if you calculate it,
so
you also have the
so, yeah, so you will. I mean, so these experiments have to be, they have to be actually, the separation has to be on the order of 100 microns to avoid that pulse interaction. But of course, you know, an interesting thing would be, too, is to get it closer and actually, I mean, also if they're charged as well, that's also an interesting experiment to do. So all of these things, I mean, so that's why, you know, it has to be a particle and so 100 microns away to get away from the particle's interaction. So you really, it is dominated by the gravitational interactions.
The van der Waals also increases the volume, because it scales the polarizability, right? So it's not the same scale. Polarizability, you know, is increasing the polarizability of a nanoparticle.
Yes.
It increases with the volume.
Yeah, but I mean, I mean, we made the calculation for the particle sizes we have, which are about a micron away, a micron in size, separated by about 100 microns. And that is a sufficient distance such that that's a minimal interaction compared to the gravitational interaction.
What about Casimir Boulder with the mirrors that you have there? If your environment is not homogeneous, then any interaction with anything is space, is position dependent.
Absolutely. Yeah.
So that's kind of an issue.
Yeah. No, I mean it's not an easy experiment. I mean, that's a sort of experiment that, you know, I mean, this way, you know, we
what I'm saying, even if you have, it's a conceptual thing, but what I'm saying, I think, if I'm correct.
Yes. It is.